My name is Ndoni Mkunu, and I am an African scientist and a climate change researcher. And I can tell you, it is not easy at all to find climate change information that is relevant to the implementation of projects on the ground for Africans. Yet, it is this information, evidence to what works and what doesn't, that can help us and direct us to the solutions that can and should be scaled up for climate action. I ask myself, is it because that information on locally led African climate action projects just hasn't yet been documented? Or it could be that the vast majority of climate research comes from the global north, from a group of people with very similar backgrounds. For example, the white male scientist. And in this group of people, the skewed nature of climate change is also skewing the body of knowledge around climate research. That climate change and climate research is biased. A study recently published by the BBC News backs me up. The study looks at 100 of the most highly cited climate research papers over the past 5 years. Fewer than 1% of the authors are based in Africa. And only 12 of the papers had a female lead researcher. And I can't help but ask myself, how many of them were female African researchers? So the question is, where are the African researchers? Where is the African climate change work? The lack of African knowledge is one important reason, in my view, that Africa keeps getting presented by donors and in the media as needing rescuing. In this dominant narrative, others need to come to the continent to help Africans with climate action. Now, don't get me wrong. Climate research and climate action are needed in Africa. Like the rest of the world, Africa is warming. And like the rest of the world, Africa and countries in Africa and regions are feeling the impact. Let's take 2019, for example. The third warmest year on record for the African continent. Parts of East Africa, especially Kenya and Somalia, experienced a widespread of flooding and drought. Following this, food insecurity in these countries increased from 2.3 million people in 2018 to 5.2 million in the late 2019. So Africa is highly vulnerable to climate change. The thing is, vulnerability goes hand in hand with effective local action to adapt to climate change. I want to give you two examples that are based in Africa of how we can implement projects that are locally led. The first is the Global Mangrove Database and Information Systems, otherwise referred to as GLOMIS. This project looks at creating a database with people, programs, publications, as well as institutions involved with mangroves. This is very important as mangroves serve a very big role in conservation as a carbon sink, as well as in providing livelihoods for rural areas. So this project looked at how it can help to avoid the duplication of research and disseminates worldwide the information stored in the database. This is important because there's a need for integrating and providing access of knowledge and information to local communities, as well as providing knowledge about conserving the mangrove and management of it. The second project that I'd like to look at is called the Delivering Food on Limited Land, otherwise abbreviated as the DEVO project. This serves as part of my PhD and seeks to map out how to feed a growing population now and in the future on limited land resources. For this, it uses high-level resolution imagery. We also use modeling in order for us to see the spatial distribution of what farmers are doing on the ground. This data sets and this information highlighted the importance of why do we need indigenous knowledge systems and empowering indigenous knowledge systems to solving the issue of food insecurity. Along the databases, we use soils, we use land use, we use crops and livestock and a range of scenarios. And this really helped us understand and dig deep as to how can we make more food for a limited population on a limited land. GLOMIS and DEVIL, for the lack of a better acronym, show that there is an African climate research, and it is already producing insights on what works and what doesn't. And it helps to understand how people can survive in climate-changing situations. So how can we create more GLOMIS and more DEVILs, as well as disseminate their learnings? How can we bring power to African climate action? We still struggle in the African context to make systematic observations about climate change, partly because many of the African countries have only sparse meteorological observation networks, and partly because there is a lack of funding. For example, to run computers with models is very expensive, and the investments in this technology will help increase the quality of the research that we put out to the world. And so we need to have better meteorological systems that are developed. But donors can also contribute to regional organizations that are within their local areas that need to be invested in. And so I want to fall into what can we do to make sure that projects can be implemented effectively at local levels and in communities. There are three aspects that I'd like to focus into. I'd like to focus into women and diversity. Inclusion of women. Women tend to have a much less dropout rate than men as they progress through the academia. This is probably due to many reasons. It could be the stereotypes, it could be the sexism, it could also just be the cultural norms that we face as women. This might also prevent them to spending as much time in their sciences, unlike their male counterparts. And so we need to make sure that the voices of women are heard, that there is a lack of voices from the global south, and there's a lack of, most importantly, women from the global south when it comes to hampering and discussing issues of climate change. The second issue that I'd like to move into is that when we look into the hierarchy of information, and this is called the decolonization of information. So even when researchers from better off countries seek to collaborate with colleagues from developing countries, their efforts don't always come out well, or it doesn't always end up well. Northern scientists often bring their own grad students from the north, and they tend to view their local partners as more facilitators rather than actual scientists. And this can be done through them focusing on admin and language rather than focusing on the real science. This is called helicopter science, where extracting resources and data from developing nations without any collaboration to local research. Local knowledge needs to be treated as equally relevant and important as peer-reviewed papers. The art to ensure impact and climate action, where the gap between knowledge and action is reduced, we need to really ask ourselves, who is defining the research question? Funding models need to also have a longer time frame to ensure that the impact is measured accurately. Organizations also need to engage with locals to understand the problem, as well as to understand the solutions and discuss them from the beginning of the research, rather than discussing the results at the end of the project. So in conclusion, I'd like to ask you that even and every time that you read an African story on climate change or an African project, ask yourself, who is telling the story, and from which narrative lens is the story being told? Thank you.